For all of my life so far, I've been a big Windows/PC user. I've always thought of Macs as overly expensive and big waste of money, to be honest, but things change, I guess. In November 2020, Apple released the M1 Max onto the world, and my PC fanboyness had to sit to the side because, like I said before, times change. So, what is the M1 Mac Mini like, and what is it like from the perspective of a longtime PC user? Well, hopefully, I can answer that in this video. I recorded myself unboxing and setting up the M1 Mac Mini, so you'll be seeing a lot of those clips here. It came in a very nice, sleek box, as you would expect from Apple. I did have some trouble opening the box, though, and you'll see that in this clip.
You gotta do this whole sliding off thing, and it's not easy to do with one hand.
This thing looks really sleek, and I can see where Apple gets its reputation for making both sturdy and just beautiful product.
All right, look at this thing. Ooh, all shiny and out of focus because phone cameras suck. As you can see, pretty snazzy stuff.
Anyway, once I plugged in my mouse, keyboard, and my power cord, it was time to turn it on for the first time, and they brought back the best thing about Macs.
All right, and here comes the powering on. Aw, man, they brought the ding back? Oh, that's cool. They used to not have that sound.
The headphone jack, though, is in a fairly inconvenient spot when you have two USB-A ports plugged in, and I definitely noticed that when I tried to plug in my speakers.
Where's the headphone jack? It's gotta have a headphone jack, right? Please? Hold on, let me find it.
Mac OS contains a built-in screen reader called VoiceOver.
Oh, there it is. Okay, had to find the headphone jack. It was kinda not in a very good place. I almost thought it didn't have one for a second. US. America!
I mean, it's not that big of a deal, but it's pretty inconvenient. I don't have any more footage of me, you know, doing first impressions, so it's back to me talking now instead of like 2 weeks ago. When I first got to the desktop, I was pretty impressed with this UI. I mean, macOS Big Sur looks far better than Windows 10. It's, you know, Windows 10's alright, but macOS Big Sur just outshines it by far. Now, that was more my first impressions. How about what it's actually like once you start using it? Let's get a bit more analytical. macOS Big Sur isn't just a looker. The performance and general snappiness of the OS feels just excellent, especially compared to Windows 10, where after a while, it starts to slow down a little bit, even on good hardware. Here are my PC specs. I mean, this is not a bad computer by any means. It's just macOS Big Sur feels a lot nicer. The thing I had to try out immediately was Rosetta 2, Apple's answer to x86 to ARM conversion. Rosetta 2 is amazing. Once you give it a little bit to translate all the x86 instructions to ARM, it opens your app and they work as good as they will on pretty well-specced Intel chips. Even Adobe Premiere Pro, which is currently an Intel-only app, works flawlessly through Rosetta 2, and in fact, it even felt a little snappier than my Windows PC, which I was pretty surprised about. And by the way, once you launch an Intel app once, Rosetta 2 actually ends up caching what it did, so that way, the next time you open the app, it's just as snappy. And that is a really cool thing. This is an awesome feature, and I'm glad Apple was able to do it. Of course, M1 optimized apps work even better than Rosetta apps, and I've given a few of them a good shot. One of them is actually a pretty in-development beta of Premiere that supports M1 natively. I have to say, the render times are much better than the Intel emulated Premiere. It'll probably only get better from here as well. Speaking of fast rendering times though, Final Cut Pro on M1 is just pure insanity. It even blows away Premiere. I made a 30-second test video with moving and scaled up images, one of the images being 30 megabytes in size, and it rendered in about 10 to 15 seconds max. Premiere using Rosetta 2, however, usually takes about 35 to 60-ish seconds for me to render something similar. Once the M1 can actually be fully taken advantage of by more apps, we will see performance that is insane for a $700 machine. My PC cost $500 more in 2018, by the way. Something else that seemed cool to me at first was being able to run certain iOS apps right on my Mac. So I downloaded the Funny Game and tried it out, and this is where my praises do end. I mean, it's really cool to see iOS apps running on Mac, and I'm sure that this feature would be very useful for certain development cases. However, the experience of using the apps is not that great. Among Us for iOS is definitely not optimized for Macs whatsoever, and it shows. It's still pretty cool to have this as a PC user, as, you know, Windows can't run iOS apps whatsoever, and can't even run Android apps without downloading and setting up emulators. Well, the M1 has this feature out of the box. The other big thing I don't like about this, however, is how Apple keeps re-enabling and disabling the ability to sideload iOS apps. This means that manually installing iOS apps can be randomly disabled, which is not okay in my opinion. Apple needs to keep this enabled, and that's easily fixed by just leaving it enabled. Something that can't be fixed with an update, however, is the lack of more than two USB-A and C ports. Like, really, Apple? Why are there lacking ports on a desktop computer? I understand it for the MacBooks. After all, they already have a keyboard and trackpad, and most people will be fine with that. However, on a desktop computer, you need to plug in your keyboard and mouse, and bam, there goes both your USB-A ports, which is incredibly annoying for using flash drives, microphones, or webcams, which using webcams is pretty essential nowadays in the COVID age. Sure, you could buy a hub, but I think Apple really should give you four ports. Not the biggest deal, I suppose, but it does feel lacking, especially compared to my PC, which has five USB 3.0 ports and three USB 2.0 ports. Something that I am actually really concerned about, though, is that it utilizes a lot of swap space. If you don't know, swap space is basically where your computer writes some content meant for RAM to your hard disk, in this case an SSD, to essentially have more RAM for storing stuff like cached versions of commonly used apps, or just as an extra buffer in case the RAM gets too full. Either way, excessive usage of this swap space can lead to SSD failure, as SSDs are flash storage, and flash storage has a certain lifespan that entirely depends on the write cycles, or how many times you write to it. Hopefully, Apple will be able to patch this to an extent in future Big Sur updates, as I actually do know a friend of a friend whose M1 Mac died because of the excessive swap. This is especially apparent when looking at a Windows laptop I was on at school recently. This school PC has 8GB of RAM, and yet it was only using about 260MB of swap space compared to gigabytes on macOS. But speaking of Windows PCs, where does this whole PC user stick come into play? Well, I also want to discuss the switch from a Windows PC to the M1 Mac Mini. Switching from my Windows PC to my M1 Mac Mini was quite a leap, especially at first, but I am really starting to love the Mac experience. The biggest hurdle with switching is the completely different operating systems. macOS is an entirely different experience from Windows 10 in several huge ways. First of all, there is no start menu. Instead, that stuff is found in the Apple logo menu in the top bar. Also, having a separate dock and top bar instead of one big task bar is a weird switch. Speaking of that top bar, applications also put their context menus in that top bar, which is certainly an adjustment from Windows, as apps put their context menus inside the app itself. The way you manage your applications is also completely different in a great way. Apps are self-contained folders on macOS, meaning it makes for easy uninstallation of a huge majority of apps, namely the ones that don't use .package installers, which are becoming fairly rare nowadays. Most apps come as .dmg files, which open a little prompt where you drag the app's icon into your applications folder, and bam, it's done. I actually love this, but it was definitely a huge shift from Windows at first. Another one of the huge changes is keyboard shortcuts. God, I was so annoyed at first by everything that's usually binded to control something instead of being binded to command, or in my keyboard's case, the Windows key. Trust me, if you're a longtime PC user, this will annoy you at first. However, overall, I feel like the Switch was worth it for my more productive things. Windows, on the other hand, is still definitely a far better choice for any real gaming experience. But alright, let's wrap this whole thing up. In conclusion, there is a lot to love about M1 Max, and even this little Mac Mini here. The Mac Mini is great as a cheap-ish entry into the exciting M1 world, especially if you have a lot of peripherals already, like I do. The performance of M1 is staggeringly good, especially for being an ARM chip. Before, I thought of ARM as just a cheap chip for phones, but now it's a serious contender to change desktop computing as we know it. However, like I previously stated, there are several issues, mainly relating to iOS app usage, the excessive swap file usage, and, well, especially for the PC user in me, the lack of ports. So here's the big picture. Do I recommend that longtime PC users like me buy this? Well, it depends. If you really want macOS, and a very snappy macOS experience at that, then I'd say go for it. If you are far more of a productivity user, such as using Microsoft Office or Adobe products, you will definitely love the M1 Mac Mini. Once you get used to macOS, that is. Also, for developers, the M1 Mac Mini is great. Using Visual Studio Code, which now has a native Apple Silicon version, works great. And building web apps with Vue and React work great and was a pretty pleasant experience, especially compared to Windows, as ZSH, which felt really similar to Bash for me, is definitely better than using PowerShell. Ugh. And M1 does seem to do quite a bit to decrease compiling times. However, for big gamers, I would definitely stay away. This is not a gaming machine at all, despite Apple's attempts to try to appeal to that crowd on their website. Also keep in mind that this is first generation hardware. The next generation chip may appeal to you more, as it's rumored to be fixing a lot of the limitations that M1 has, such as no more than 2 displays, no more than 2 USB A and C ports, and more than 16 gigs of RAM. If you want any of those things, save your money for the next generation Apple Silicon chip. If you don't mind these issues, however, and want to pull the trigger, I'd say go ahead. I can assure you that you won't regret it. Alright, thank you everyone for watching. I hope this video was decent at helping you decide whether or not to buy an M1 Mac Mini and the perspective of a PC user. You may notice that I look a lot fancier than usual, and that's thanks to my cameraman in the background there, Oscar Lopez. You can check out his photography Instagram in the link in the description below. Thank you guys.